course, we can choose straight as a gate. Narrow as a way, broad as a way. The gate, the way that leads to destruction. God, you didn't make us serve you. You give us a choice. You left it up to us to choose it. And I thank you for what it was in my heart chose to serve you. God, I love you and I thank you, Jesus. We come to you for this day. And as we go into this new week, God, go with us. We know you, the Almighty, and it's about souls. God, in the name of Jesus, you come to not to condemn the world, but to save them. You didn't come to judge them, but to save them. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for that love that you look down upon the weakness of man, that he was no good. You made him in your image, but he went in another direction. But I thank you that a few of us, you've cast that net out there and cast that spirit out there and reached out with your hand and we accepted it. And I come to you today, Jesus. Or as we go in this new week, God, we ask for your blessings. We know that you're more than a conqueror. You made us more than a conqueror through you that loved us, that we can resist the devil and he will flee, that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord, you said you'd answer them. We ask for the needs, God, all these prayer requests, these 300 or 400 of them or more already come in, God, these few services. Don't let a one of them be unattended to. God, we ask for every solitary name that's written down to requesting prayer or for someone else. Send your word. God, the Bible said you sent your word and delivered them out of all of their destruction. Oh, that men would praise the Lord. We know that you're the same God. You said, I am the Lord your thy God, the Lord your God. And you said you would not change. And I bend my knees and reaching out my heart, trying to bend my heart, submit myself to the mighty hand of God. Search the hearts of every person out here, Lord, today. Jesus, we ask, God, as we start this new week, we ask for your mighty blessings and every need that's coming in through prayer, or those that's coming through the prayer line. God, reaching out, Lord, you grant unto them their needs. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, in the name of Jesus, you said they that wait upon the Lord, You said they'd get an answer, Lord. We look upon you, Jesus. We're casting our cares. We bring, and you said, make our requests known to you. God, these are needs, special needs, family needs. Move. Some of them got broken up families, Lord. Even last night of the line, some of them, they let them whisper in my ear their need. They was more concerned about their families and what they was going through than themselves. God, we need you, Jesus. We can't help ourselves by ourselves. Lord, all we can do is diligently. You said those that hunger and thirst after righteousness, those that diligently with all their heart seek you. You made us a promise. I shall be found of you when you seek me with all your heart. And every time a prayer's answered, God, we know it's you. Lord, I couldn't cure a flea, a fly with a sprained ankle, God. Lord, it's all your power. It's your love. It was you that took the laceration. It was you that bore our grief, Jesus. It was you, Jesus, that nailed our sins to the tree, that we might be made the righteousness of God in you. God, you gave Jesus a name above every name. There's no name in heaven and earth can match or even get us close as a shadow. Lord, it's you. Lord, we're just little old creatures, finite creatures. You, the Almighty. You, the one that let us make man. You, the one that made the heavens and the earth and fill the sea, all the different things that's in the sea. Oh, God. Smile on us, Lord. You said your hand, your arm ain't short. Reach out to us. Show us you can save us. Blot out our transgressions and renew our faith and our dedication. Thank you, Father. If you got a special need in your life, praying with somebody. I'm always have somebody on my heart out there for praying for them. If you got somebody that you're praying for, family member, relative, God, right now, Lord, we ask you to look down upon the relatives and closest of kin and maybe across the street neighbor, God, or friend. Remember them, Lord. God, remember them, Lord. We ask in the name of Jesus. God, in the name of Jesus, everyone that's reaching out to you right now, God, hear the cry. Lord, it ain't just the mouth, it's from the heart. The man bleeds, it's the heart the woman bleeds to righteousness. Oh, Jesus, move, God, these this day and this evening, as this crusade, Lord, goes on into the final days, Lord. God, you told me you'd send me to the other side of the world one time when I complained for one soul. And you did. Because I griped. God, Jesus. Oh, God, you taught me a lesson, Lord. It's about souls, and it just always the multitudes. God, in the name of Jesus. God, in the name of Jesus. God, in the name of Jesus, Lord. Have mercy upon the Macon area. Lord, cast your big old hand over all the churches that's hungry. I know some of the churches going as far as they're going to go. They're saved and satisfied. Lord, I've never been satisfied. Thank you for sanctifying me, but you didn't satisfy me. You told me to keep knocking. Keep seeking. Keep asking. Keep hungering. God, I thank you for helping me to never lose my hunger. Hola, hey, Yesa. Holy One of Israel, I call upon you, Nabola. Leto, Lanabandan, Zansesa, Kashawa. Lord, have mercy, Lord. God, have mercy, Lord. Have mercy, Lord. God, have mercy, Lord. Upon this city, have mercy upon this state, have mercy upon these country areas, Lord. Oh, mighty God. Lord, and everyone that's here that's got a special need in their lives, you the way maker. Jesus, you the way maker. One day you made a way for us. If we'll strive to enter the straight gate. We know there's probably thousands and millions out there trying to get in and can't because they messed around in the world, and the doctor said they weren't going to live but a few days or months. They tried to get in, and some of them never made it because they waited to the last hour. God in heaven, help us to get up front, Lord. Help us to press. Get in this door, and we'll honor you, and we'll praise you. Oh, we'll praise you, and we thank you. God, as every heart and hand goes up to you for a need in their lives, Lord, don't let these 6 days to follow this day of God, according to your will, let it be so. God, in the name of Jesus. God, let it be so. Put your hands up and praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Lord, we just thank you. God, we just, Holy Ghost, thank you. God, we just thank you, thank you, thank you. Lord, we just thank you. God, we glorify you. We glorify you, Jesus. God, we exalt your name, Jesus, above every name in heaven and in earth. We're striving to lift you up as high as we can get you up there, Jesus. Because you said if you be lifted up, you're going to draw people to you. And we'll glorify you. Oh, Jesus. Lord, just one soul, we glorify you. Everybody lift your hand up and tell the Lord you love him. Oh, I love him. Love him more than any being on earth. Thank you, Jesus. Love Jesus above ever bothers have been an enemy or friend or brother or sister. Put your hands up if you love him. You're trying to keep his commandments. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his name. I said, praise his name. Reach over and take somebody's hand and tell them, if you're breathing, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. So if you ain't breathing, don't do it. Ain't that what he said? Everything that's breathing. If you ain't breathing, don't do it. But if you're breathing, praise the Lord. I said, if you're breathing, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Glory to Jesus. Mighty God is he. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus lived upon this earth, paid a price no man could pay, shed his precious blood, and he washed my sins away. He was God in the flesh, and he never knew no sin. He said, we've got to pay a price to be like him. Tell me who's going to pay the price. Jesus said to pay. Who's going to sacrifice their time? Who's going to fast and pray? Who's going to love their neighbor? Teach little children how to pray. Tell me who's going to pay the price. Jesus said to pay. Who's going to love their enemies? Who's going to feed the poor? Who's going to visit the widows, fatherless once more? Who's going to preach the ones out in the streets? Pray for the ones in jail. Who's going to pray for a dying world on its road to hell? Tell me who's going to pay the price. Jesus said to pay. Who's going to sacrifice their time? Who's going to fast and pray? Who's going to love their neighbor? Teach little children how to pray. Tell me who's going to pay the price. Jesus said to pay. Who's going to go to India? Preach to the Hindu man. Who's gonna take this Jesus news to the foreign land? Who's gonna go to Africa, cry, behold the Lamb? Who's gonna lift up Jesus to a lost and a dying world? Tell me who's gonna pay the price. Jesus said to pay. Who's gonna sacrifice their time? Going fast and pray. Who's gonna love their neighbor? Teach little children how to pray. Tell me who's gonna pay the price. Jesus said to pay. Praise him a little bit. All the way, Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. If I falter while I'm trying, don't be angry, let me lay. Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. Excuse me, Lord, in thy service, draw me nearer every day. Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. all the way. If I fail you while I'm trying, don't be angry, let me lay. Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. Pain by heartache, scorn by loved ones, a little sunshine now and then. But I'm willing to run all the way. If I fail you while I'm trying, why I'm trying to get in, Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. All the way. All the way. Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. If I fail you while I'm trying, don't be angry, let me lay. Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. Just a few more years give me, Lord, I'll reach all the world, 'cause I'm willing to run all the way. No matter what the danger, as you send me across the earth, Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. All the way. All the way. Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. If I fail you while I'm trying, don't be angry, let me lay. Lord, I'm willing to run all the way. Lift your hands up and praise Him if you're willing to run. This is a race. I said, this is a race. And you have to put everything in. You know, I was blessed to have the fastest Georgia horse that won 3 years straight all the races ahead. And I was also blessed for the horse that got the Cripple Crown winner 3 years back to back. You know, but you know, and that was, I mean, one day I got on that horse, and that horse was going so fast till we come beside a school bus, and I looked over, and that school bus speeding up was on 42 miles an hour, and he passed that school bus. I got so scared, I just held on to the stirrup. Man, I held on to that horn up there. I thought, God, if I get out of this alive, I let old Van Buren run by himself. Hallelujah. But you know, but I learned something. You got to have something in you to run. You got to have something, a doctor on that horse. And I prayed for a lot of his patients. And he said, yeah, I'm going to bless you for the horse that's a winner. And that's what I want to be, a runner. I mean, the Bible, that's right. The Bible teaches we got to run. Got to press. Thank you, Jim. We get out here. Well, how many remember when you was a kid? Maybe it wasn't a bunch of y'all. Mama said, holler, dinner time, dinner's ready, supper. We didn't know anything about all this your modern kind of meals. It was breakfast, dinner, and supper, wasn't it? Now people don't know what supper is. So dumb. But praise God. When Mama said breakfast, boy, we jumped up. We just have to go feed the hogs and the chickens while she getting breakfast. Man, us kids would knock one other down to get there first. Thank you, Jesus. God's still that same God. I said, God's that same God, ain't He? Same today as He was yesterday. I pray every day, come Lord Jesus. But I want to be ready whether He comes that in the clouds or comes for me. I want to be ready. It's dangerous this day and time not to get ready and stay ready. Bible said, be ready for hour you think not. The Son of Man come. Don't you know right now that we're in that hour? The Bible speaks about this time there, how what kind of shape we'd get in, you know? Lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. And all that's written in there, it's all filled, isn't it? All filled. The only thing I know that's lacking is that beast that John saw rising up out of the sea with a number. Sea represents people. To give up now, they're already talking about that. You know, most of the babies born by the doctors, they get a little chip put at them now, unless the parents forbid them. But somewhere, and I've always said it wasn't just something on your forehead. The Bible never did say that. Bible said they're going to put a number in your head. Well, 10 years ago, they couldn't have done that. 5 years ago, they couldn't have done that. But now, they got a little chip as big as a half a grain of rice that's got everything about you in it. He said, well, I don't know about it. Well, I tell you one thing about it. If you was born, they registered your birth certificate. When you were born, they got your name up there. Well, I better hush. Some of y'all be cutting your head off trying to get that chip out there. God's good, ain't he? I'm going to take a moment here to... I'm going to pull his coat off, I think, in a moment. I felt like talking to you today in a few moments here, but not right now. Put on the whole arm of God that you may be able to stand and withstand what's ahead of us, you know. How many believe this? Well, let me tell you, I want to be able to stand. I never have thought about dying. I always told the Lord, if I am going to die, just let me go to sleep and wake up yonder somewhere on them streets of gold, paved with pure gold. Jesus said he's going to prepare a new heaven and a new earth, and I don't know how long it's going to take him. They've been working on that now for over 2,000 years, hasn't he? That's what he said he's going to do. And I ain't read nowhere where he throw the towel in. I believe he's making a new heaven. Somebody said, why are you going to do that? Because that nigga got up there now, or the one we had, the devil's in it. And they had to throw him out. And this new heaven ain't never going to meet no devil in this one. And not only that, but a third of the angels got thrown out with him. So that heaven up there now that you want to go to, it's a devil heaven. I want to go to the heaven that Jesus said, I'm going to go and prepare a new heaven and a new earth. Don't you believe he's doing it? We say, well, the Bible said it, and if that's not so, what else in the Bible ain't so? I believe all of it, as I believe the whole book. Every ye, I always say you. But ye and you, same thing. That's just a no English word that they do have a King James Bible out that took out the ye's, but to put the you, same thing. I got both kind, but it's all the same. I didn't get to go to school until I was this little bit of my life, and while I was going through some battles of mine, I got a chance to, the government put me through 4 years. I had a choice, and so I chose the choice to go to school. And I didn't learn what y'all did. Most of all, I said, all I want to do, learn how to add and to read. I remember I had a teacher, you know, and I'd tell the Bible and I'd be reading and I'd say, she rebuked me for saying ye. Well, she tried to correct me. She told me to get rid of the haints and the taints and the taint. I said, hand me a nothing. She, boy, she'd get all over me for saying nothing. I said, well, you need to have been born in Alabama, Georgia. Y'all, old northerners, don't even know what ye is. Man, a nothing is, hand me another egg, another nut, a biscuit. Ain't that right? I mean, people are dumb, it ain't Georgia, ain't they? Man, all these aristocrats, they so dumb, born up here in New York, why, you can't even understand how to talk. Sound like a bunch of buzzards out there eating a dead horse or something. But I appreciate the Lord. I do appreciate the Lord. And I appreciate the government for giving me 4 years of to help me, you know. Thank the Lord. God is good. I got to go home maybe 3 times because it was a 24/7 situation, and I tell you, I appreciate it. God's good. I said, the Lord is good. Thank the Lord. I worked in the hospital some, and I tell you, they let me work in the hospital about 5 or 6 hours a day. And man, every time I went to the hospital, people got in beds and went home. I remember one time in Atlanta, they had me apart at Emory. Pray for a man. They sent me in there to pray for a man, pray for somebody across the room, hollered, come pray for me. I went over and in the next room all the way down to the nurse's thing in the middle. And every slapped person in the room hollered, pray for me. Everybody got up and got their clothes on and checked out. Got down there where the nurses thing, somebody hollered over there. So I went down that side. And man, people getting up, everybody but one person. That was a man that got in a bad car wreck and had him all nailed up, you know, the nails sticking through him and all that. But he got healed, but they had to take him nails out before he could get up. Got down there to the end, and a doctor from Emory there was down there helping somebody. Boy, they was in bad shape. Prayed for him, they got up. Boy, he looked at me. He said, who are you? He said, I know who you is. Said, I heard about you. Said, they said some fella named Terrell would just go anywhere and pray for folk. Said, your name got to be David Terrell. I said, well, what does that matter? Don't matter. He said, but will you please do me one favor? He said, I've got to go upstairs. It's the nurses up there where the babies are born. And I don't know who put all that in there. Where the babies are born. And said, let me deliver the babies. That's what he said. I said, man, I ain't want to deliver your babies. He said, well, I just want to give you sure. I got to go up there and deliver them babies. And so that whole thing there, man, got turned upside down, and they wasn't a person that didn't get healed. They took that guy in to get all them nails out of him. And about 15 years later, I was preaching down close to the Florida line. And I had a woman up there, so critical, that been in a car wreck, there's no way she could ever be fixed. And the doctor up there said, my dad used to be over at the hospital. Said, there's a man somewhere by the name of David Terrell. We find him. Said he tells my dad told a story how he came in his Hebrew hospital. Everybody is in here got healed. Said, we can find him. We'll put you in the ambulance. And they went on the internet and found that I was on the border of Florida. This is true, but it makes me cry every time I think about it. And that brother sat over there last night. He would know about that, you know, from down there on the, where he was from, that other brother. He was young and he took it back, what I'm saying. Because he got a church down that way. Thank you, Jesus. And so I went out to that little church almost on the side, but it's right on the edge of Florida line. I walked out there and to receive the offering out here, and just a moment I walked a high platform, and there was a stretcher right down here. And I said, wait a minute, we can't take no offering right now. I went down there, and I had a doctor with her. And she had nails sticking everywhere. And that doctor said, my dad was head doctor at Emory. And you came in there one time, prayed for everybody, and everybody got healed. Said, I've come down here with this woman. That was his son. And I noticed that ambulance sitting over her. Said, I brought her down here in that ambulance. And that ambulance driver drove her, and I've come with her. I got down on my knees at that stretcher, and God divinely gave that woman a supernatural miracle. She got off that stretcher, went out there, got in that ambulance beside that driver and that other guy that come with her. Sat back on the back, and they drove out of there. Hallelujah. Don't you know, they went back to Atlanta, and that store went over Atlanta. Man, they demanded that I put the biggest tent in the world up. Hallelujah. I mean, God still had God. Hallelujah. I ain't never forgot that. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus Christ, he is the same yesterday. I've had people say, can't you talk about nothing else but Jesus? I said, no. Amen. Then why? I said, y'all talk about all that other, and I'm making up for y'all. Yeah. Y'all wonder why I talk about Jesus much? Y'all don't talk about it, so I'm filling in for you. Yeah. Hallelujah. I said, hallelujah. I said, I'm filling in for you. Glory. I said, and you know, that's why I got that name, Jesus Man. Everywhere I went, there's that Jesus man. There's that Jesus man. I'm not ashamed to be called a Jesus man. Hallelujah. I preached in over 200 countries. Been out here longer than any evangelist ever was in history. Man, if I didn't meet that guy in California out there, he was a friend of mine. You know, he was lived to be 100 and something. But back, he told me, he came to my meeting. He was one of them big shots out there. He told me, I tell you what you need to do. You need to do what I done. When I got on 39, I got on holding. And he explained to me. So me and him, he put me on 39. And you know, he lived to be over 100. And stayed up there. And I got myself on 39. Man, I throwed away the keys. Hallelujah. I said, hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. I said, glory to Jesus. I remember sometime back, I have a sweet wife, and she turned 40. And that was her birthday. And I said, boy, I just smiled and hugged. I said, you know what? You older than me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I said, you older than me. I said, I'm on 39 and holding. When I met her, she was 27. She says, I'm getting on 27. I'm going to be 27. I said, no, you ain't. You forgot to put it on hold. I said, I said, this is a cruise thing. She said, well, I'm getting on hold right now. Hallelujah. Glory. And you know, and y'all make yourselves old. Amen. Run around, y'all, my, I'm getting older. Lord, it just... A few days ago, God, on a Sunday and on a Saturday, God, we prayed for anointed 400 preachers the other Saturday, Jesus, and we need ministers to be refreshed. God, we need it, and I pray that it be so, and Jesus, bless this word. Thank the Lord. I believe we're at an hour that the Lord, and I want to read some here in Ephesians 6. Thank the Lord. And I want to talk about put on the whole armor of God. If we've ever in our lives clothed ourselves spiritually, you know, back in the time of the Bible, and they still got countries that do that, and even men that is in war eras, they don't just wear common clothes, they got things that they put across that bounce a bullet off. And the Irish people, I preached in Ireland a lot years ago, and in Ireland they always protected their, they wore short clothes, but they protected this part of the body, you know, because they know this is where if somebody tries to kill you and they have them helmets, they're going to try to shoot you in the head or in here. Well, that's what the armor of God means in God's book. That you got on, when you got on that whole armor of God spiritually, it's like people, and they've done this for thousands of years. That just didn't start 200 or 300 years ago, 100 years ago. This started back hundreds and thousands of years ago. That soldiers went out to fight, and that's where the Christianity got that word from. Put the armor on, be protected from the devil. Kelp. You know, some people have thought about this way and that way, because when the enemy comes in like a flood, the preachers have not taught them that they got something in them that fights back. Greater is he that's in you, and that he that's in you is not you in you. It is Christ in you. And the Apostle Paul here, being, you know, he was a persecutor, and he was a high up, what we'd call today, top guy in what we'd call a military, and when he got saved. And that's reading Paul at the end said, I've fought a good fight. Last words he said, because he was a fighter. Yes. And that's what's wrong with the churches today. Well, preachers in these churches, it's just a three songs and a little prayer and amen and go home. We need some clothes on. Yes. But we don't need this stuff we bought out of Walmart. We don't need to run around here buying Walmart stuff. That's cheap stuff. We need to get some stuff. That stuff ain't going to last. I tell you what, you get you about four or five of these t-shirts that will come down here that you're wearing underneath and then wash them. That'll be above your neighbor. Amen. Amen. While the old cloth draws up. But you go to a real apartment store that sells that stuff has been put through the hot water. It's done drawed up, and it's done been, and that's right, it's done been drawed. Ain't gonna draw up no more. You see these preachers running around here, you don't get a new pair of breeches, and I have to wear them the same way up like this, running around here, because it's old stuff that hadn't been through the war, you know. And that's what's real wrong with some of these Christians. We go to church one time and we go home and draw up. Yes. Hallelujah. When God began to wash you with the Holy Ghost, He began to fill you with the real truth. You begin to shrink. Hallelujah. But if you'll get you some old time religion, thank God, hallelujah, you ain't gonna draw up no more. I said you're gonna be able to stand up and fight back. God makes you out of good material. Hallelujah. He makes you out of material when He saves you. You ain't gonna draw up. You ain't gonna back up from God. You're gonna go over God. You're gonna grow. You're gonna grow in grace. You're gonna grow in the statue. You're gonna go up to a full statue of the body of Jesus Christ. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. I want to tell you something. The devil has been around a long time. Yeah. Even one time with one of the bright angels in God's kingdom. Come on, brother. That's right. One time he was so important till he got a third of the angels join again in with him to try to whoop heaven. He did. Amen. Ain't that right?
That's right.
The Bible said there's war in heaven. But the devil didn't have as many people on his side he thought he did. The Lord had 2/3 bigger than he was. 3/4 bigger than he was. Hallelujah. And the devil, they got to fighting with his little fourth or his little third. Man, God's holy men of God, holy angels of God, praise God, they throwed the devil out on top of his head and throwed his angels out. Then the Bible said, God throwed out of heaven. Hallelujah. And that's what we need to do. We need to get a gospel, throw the devil out of the church. I said, throw the devil out of the church. I was reading, the church ain't moving. The devil's in the church. If we'll get the Holy Ghost, we'll get Jesus on our side. Praise God. Hallelujah. We'll throw the devil out of church. We'll throw all this here can't be done out of the church. We'll get back to the old landmark. We'll get back, hallelujah, to the fullness of the Godhead. We'll get back to the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And we'll fight the devil and we'll win over the devil. I said we're more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ of Nazareth. But we got to get in here and get to fighting. You are more than what you think you are if you are a child of God. You got the baptism of the Holy Ghost? Well, the devil ain't got the baptism of the goat. A holy goat. We got the Holy Ghost, not a holy goat. And we're more than a conqueror. God and the church ain't even reached this peak yet. We're not reached the peak. God just got rid of some of these hypocrites. God been weeding out the weeds. I don't know about y'all. I was right now more of that what's called drag weeds. And them old bitter weeds. And sometimes they go deep and just run around, chop them down. Don't help them. You got to get out there with a little hoe and dig around and get him up. Pull him up by the roots. That's the reason the devil come back sometime. You cut him off and he grows back. You got to pull him up. You got to pull him up by the roots. Hallelujah. And you get the roots of sin out of you. You get the roots of the devil out of you. All them old things that brings you down, that grows back, you get that out of you. Pretty soon you are strong in the Lord. And you are powerful in him. And you can stand up to the devil. And you can rebuke the devil. And you can stand up to him. And the devil will be no match to you. I don't care if you won and he comes in with a host of his hellish angels. You can whoop every one of them. You can resist them. Stand up to the devil. And that's what Paul is teaching here. Paul was out there in the world. He was a top guy in a world that persecuted Christians. Yes, sir. That's when he could write these good books. God had to save one devil out of all the 12. And I'm glad he saved Paul. Peter and some of them, like I am, they didn't get no education. Paul had it all. Did you know he was a top guy if you study about him? You couldn't go no higher than Paul. Back then it was Saul. You couldn't go no higher than him in knowledge. But when God saved him, changed his brain, give him that new mind, give him that Holy Ghost, here Paul come out teaching me and you, we're more than a conqueror through that man up yonder at the right hand of the Father. We're more than a defeater through that man named Jesus. A man called Jesus. A man tearing that bed one day on a Sabbath when him old hypocrite said, don't you know you're not supposed to be doing that on a Sabbath? He said, yeah, I know that, but said, I laid up right that old lake and trying to get in when the water's troubled. You wouldn't help me. But the man come by and put me in there, and I got healed. Told me to get off my bed. Thank God. You always beat me in there. But he said, get your bed up, and I'm going home. Hallelujah. He said, yep, this is the time. He said, I don't care what it is. I'm going home. I'm taking my bed with me. Thank God you can go home and take your bed with you. Hallelujah. God makes you more than a conqueror. Thank you, Jesus. Well, he's a devil. He healed you on the Sabbath day. He said, I don't be care where he be a devil or he don't be a devil. I was down there and couldn't get nowhere, but this man got me going. Hallelujah. I said, hallelujah. I said, hallelujah. We're fixing to get going for God. We're fixing to get going for Jesus. Catch him, somebody. Glory. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory. I said glory. Thank you, Jesus. This battle ain't over. That ain't over. God letting all the hypocrites get lined up together, ain't he? But out of it, God get raising him a church. Yes, he is, brother. Somebody a while back said, preacher, what are you talking about? Well, this old church today, he ain't coming back for it. It's got so many wrinkles in it. Take God a lifetime, get them all out. You got so many spots in it, there ain't enough water in heaven.
That's right.
To wash them out. Ain't that right? Man, this bunch going to heaven. They ain't gonna have much spots have to be washed out. We're gonna get them washed out down here. We're gonna get all these sins washed out. We're gonna get all these little foxes out. Jesus right now chasing these little foxes out of you and I. He's chasing these little devils away from her. He's putting the devil behind her. He said, devil, get behind me. He's telling you right now, devil, get behind you. He's got them little foxes chasing them plumb out of your life. Chasing them plumb out of your home. Chase them plumb out of your mind that you're fixing to stand up here. Thank God he's giving you an armor. I said he putting an armor. I heard this morning he said, I'm putting an armor on my people, on my soldiers, on my sons and daughters. So what about the devil? I tell that devil, just like you scream out your wife, or your wife screamed out to you sometimes. Go to hell. That's what y'all say to one another. Go to hell. That's what I tell the devil. I don't say that to nobody. I tell the devil, go to hell, devil. Get out of here. Ain't that what y'all say? Go to hell. That's people's word. If they get mad, go to hell. Well, I don't tell people to go to hell. I tell the devil to get back down in hell. I tell his angels to get to hell. I say, devil, hell, angels, go back to, and that's what the Bible called them, hell's angels. I said, hell's angels, you get back to hell. You get back down out of the devil. I don't need you out here trying to get in my path. Get behind me. Jesus said he puts the devil behind you, and he puts Jesus up front. He gives you power, and he gives you a breastplate. He gives you an armor. Hallelujah. Kick him between the straddle. Hallelujah. Glory. I feel the Holy Ghost. I guess I've snapped today, but I feel the Holy Ghost. That's what these kickboxers do. Well, I'm going to find out how they're doing. I'm going to kick the devil between his legs. On his chin, that's a bad place to kick it. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. And that's what the Bible says. Stand up to the word resist. Look it up in the Greek. Stand up. That's the word that was put in resist. Stand up to the devil. Put on the whole arm of God that you might be able to stand against the wiles, the tricks, the scams of the devil. And you know it's the truth. And he's not down there in front of the beer joint. He's out in front of the church. Amen. The devil done told all these people going to church, man, you can go in there. Devil done told these women, you can go ahead and put on men's clothes. That just... Paul didn't like women. That's what they say about Paul, because he, that was a lie. Paul was a writer of God. They said, well, Paul just didn't like women. That wasn't it at all. Paul, yeah, when he was a sinner, he was a sinner. He got saved. He was just, he loved the women as much as he loved the men, far spiritually. And he taught the women to wear women clothes, and he taught the men to wear men clothes. And he told them, the ones that didn't, it was abomination. That's worse than any other kind of sin I know of. It's abomination. Abomination is not just a regular sin. It is an ungodly, out there, and almost an unforgiven kind of sin. It ain't just a little sin, more or less everyday sin. Satan's got scams. What's today, Sunday? I guarantee you, Satan went to Sunday school this morning, most of these churches. Now, everybody done out now, going to try to beat him to the restaurant. And he cut the service short about 10:30 or so, get everybody out to filling their bellies. Because the devil know most of them church folk, their bellies are God anyhow. Is that right? Amen. The Bible said the bellies are God anyhow. Everybody trying to get down there to them eat all you eat.
That's right.
Buffets.
Yes,
you better get some buff soul. You better start buffing your soul. You better start shining your shoes. And get in church. Forget about the time. Amen. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickednesses in high churches, high places. First Baptist, First Pentecostal, First Methodist. I guarantee you, what is today, Sunday? I guarantee if you was up 9 o'clock and some of them earlier, them big old churches, I guarantee you, if you went or you see these women, them little things about that long, legs are showing, and some of them, if they do have a skirt on, man, they like that. Taking pictures, Mama used to say every time. I ain't caring. They do. And them little things they got underneath ain't much to it. It's the truth. The women used to wear bloomers. Well, they don't have them no more. Nothing but nothing. You know why? God said it 2,000 years ago. It's an adulterous generation. It's a sinful generation. It's a generation, the Bible said they got to what? Conscience seared. Wrong ain't wrong no more. No matter what they do, they could steal a horse and think they could ride it to heaven. Steal a car and think they'd go down Broadway in heaven with it. They're thieves. I don't care if you don't like it. They're thieves. They've wrecked holiness. They've wrecked Pentecost. Pentecost ain't Pentecost no more. It ain't nothing but a bunch of fleas. You don't see holy women of God anymore. You don't see holy men of God anymore. If it was abomination when Paul wrote it, well, he was on the other side. But he got on the right side. Paul taught us a woman, if she wore that, that even pertains to a man, it's abomination.
That's right, amen.
You like it or not, it's just, Bible said it's a bomb. Then he went on and switched around and said, same thing, a man ain't supposed to wear that that looks like a woman either.
That's right.
And whoever do so, what? You read it, shall not enter in where? Kingdom of heaven. You ain't going to make it. I don't care if they can tell you it's all right. You ain't gonna, you're gonna wake up in hell and cuss them preachers. And if you stay down there long enough, you'll see he joins you a little later. He's not going to heaven.
That's right.
Them preachers preaching that damnation, sending people to hell, they ain't gonna make it to heaven. God's holding me responsible for the truth.
That's right. That's right.
You know what I'm telling you?
That's right.
He's holding you if you're a preacher. He's holding you if you're a preacher. He's holding that in your hands. And if you don't preach the truth, you're going to give an account of them folks that went to hell. And if they went to hell, you're going to be right there. Probably going to be their captain in hell. And the only way we can fight this war, Paul was a military man. A great fighter before he got saved. That's the reason he could write them good books. That's the reason he used the word fight, armor. He knew what a whole armor was. Back then, they couldn't even touch their head. They had a helmet up here that you know. And it slipped down over the eyes. That's right. I was reading, you see them old Bible movies, when they do that, that little thing slides back, well, they can see. I was reading, Paul taught that. He was one of, that went out of his dicks, out of his area to persecute Christians. He said, I went to strange cities and persecuted the church. I went out, but now God switched me over. And God had made him head apostle. He's above Peter. He's above Luke. He's above Matthews. Thank God. Why? He's been on both sides of the fence. Thank God. That's what's wrong today. Some of you forgot what side of the fence you used to be on, and you're still a straddle of the fence. You don't know whether you baptism or holiness. You don't know whether you Pentecost or Pentecost. You got to get on one side of that fence. You got to get in or get out. You got to lay aside every weight and every sin that goes with it, or you're going to find out one day that when that great judgment morning, you're going to judge you according to deeds done in your body, whether they be good or whether they be bad. And every bit of this is scripture. You say, well, I just fight the devil. Well, what he said? Against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual weakness, where? In church. Amen. That's the worst place it is now. Amen. And my folks on my mom's side was Baptist, my dad's side was, he was holiness, but he died there when I was six. But I remember going to church with him before I got crippled. I got crippled right after that. But I don't tell you. I remember me little kids seeing my dad there. Holy Ghost knocking him down, them shavings. Back then, there wasn't a lot of holiness. Church had brush arbors. You ever heard about the brush arbor days?
Yes, yes.
Yep. Holiness folks had to go and cut down trees on somebody's land and let them build brush arbors. They didn't have any big old churches like we do today, if you study the history. I was with my dad the day that he come home and died. Never forgot it. In fact, my mama said I went around telling folks, Holy Ghost killed my dad. You know, because I was a little kid, you know, and didn't know the difference. Wherefore, take to you the whole armor that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. Where we at right now? Don't you believe? I tell you, my lifetime, and I've been out here, started preaching, I was either 20 or 21, somewhere in there, street preacher to begin with, and that's why God trained me. But at 27 years old, had the biggest tent that ever been built in history. Because I got out there and I did have a sister, but she got married and I didn't get to have her help no more to help me learn to read. Mama helped me some, but Dad died and she had lots on her hand. And she never got married no more. But I want to tell you something. Somehow or another, God helped me to get there. Only thing I remember learning, them old preachers back in those days taught us, and the Sunday school teachers taught us, they didn't teach out of books then, they taught out of the Bible, they taught us what to call the King James original version. And they was coming out with them new Bibles, and they was warning folks by 10 that not to get them new Bibles. They condemned them. Now that's about all people got. Some of you right now got a Bible out there, don't say Holy Ghost one time in it. And if you had original King James, it says Holy Spirit three times in it, and the rest of the time it's Holy Ghost. You say, well, there's no difference. I'll tell you the difference I can prove to you right now. Everybody say Holy Spirit. Now say Holy Ghost. See how your Adam's apple jump almost out of your throat? Say Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, it'll jump every time. I like my throat to jump, don't you? Yes. Say it again, Holy Ghost. Feel, Holy Ghost. 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 Holy Wherefore take to you the whole armor of God, that you be able to withstand in the evil day. What are we in right now? The most evil day of my life. Having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins are girded about with the truth. Having on the breastplate of righteousness. Think about that. When you've done everything you do to stand, stand. When you get the whole armor on, I don't care what hell the devil puts you in to, I'm going to tell you what you do. You come out with victory. God said he'll not allow the devil put more on you and you're able to bear. We ain't only, you know, anybody can stand. I noticed on our place over there, come some high winds not too long back, just a few days or weeks ago or so, and in some of the back part of the country, some of them trees blow down, you know. And that's what God said we are, trees of righteousness. But them trees that ain't rooted and grounded, you look around, see these trees spiritually, how many of them blow down? How many preachers has blowed down? They couldn't withstand what's spiritually happening. They can't withstand all this sinful generation. Back when I come up, my mom come up, and maybe some of you, I don't know, women were women and men were men. It used to be abomination for a woman to wear that pertains to a man to wear that pertains to a woman. When I go in to buy underclothes, first thing I do, bust them open.
That's right.
And see if they are really for a man, or the one of them kind stretch up and you got to squat to pee. I don't care if you don't like it. You know it's the truth. If you don't watch, you'll have a bunch of underclothes like women. You got to squat. I don't care what you don't like. We need to get back. If it was abomination in the Bible, it's still abomination. If it's wrong one time, it's wrong two times. What we got to do is get back to God, and you'll see that glorious power that when I first come in the hole, my dad carried me, but then he passed pretty quick, and I was with him the day that he got the Holy Ghost. But I never forget how they had them shavings down there. In fact, but I went back to that area and put one of these big giant tents up and had 20,000 people where my dad was had got the Holy Ghost. And they were still, some of them old people had remembered my dad. Some of them went up, it was 100 years old and 90 years old. And they said, man, your dad said, you remind me of your dad. Even though you was a little boy then, you remind me of your dad. When he'd come in here, he had the victory. Well, that's what we need. We need to get some of them old grandpas and grandpa's Holy Ghost. We need to get some old grandmas and grandmamas and grandsons Holy Ghost. If we get that Holy Ghost that they got, you'll find when the devil sees you coming, he'll take a side street. He won't meet you on the sidewalk. When I first come into holiness, them preachers used to tell us when you get the Holy Ghost, and this is the truth, go back to history. People used to would not walk down out of the same street that a holiness person. They see a holiness person, they'd get on the other side of the street. They wouldn't walk on that. Why? It wasn't because they hated them. Them holiness people had such anointing in their life till sinners couldn't walk on the street with them. Go back to your history. I said go back then to the 40s. Go back to the 30s. You'll find that to be so that the people that was in holiness, people was afraid to walk on the street with them. Now they all look just alike. No power out there, no authority out there, and that's the reason God ain't moving like it used to. It ain't me, it ain't these pastors, it's a bunch of people out there that wants to cut it short. They want to go to heaven and live in hell down here too.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
But you got to make a choice. Got to come out of the world. Get the world out of you. Or God's going to get out of you. And if he leaves you by yourself, stand up for having your loins girded about with the truth. Having on the breastplate of righteousness. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above, take the helmet, the shell of faith, wherewith you may be able to quench all the fire darts of the devil. Take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. You know, they changed. You know, the Moffat in the King James had been one of the longest running, but now they're changed. I don't know what the Moffat's doing. I hadn't had one of them in a long time. But the King James Bible, you have to be careful. You buy one today. They're putting out Bibles that don't say Holy Ghost one time. You know, now I ain't going to have one of them. You know, it's the truth. You say, well, they just taking out there. Well, go ahead and say ye. I'd rather say ye and you if you got to take out Holy Spirit and put Holy Spirit for Holy Ghost. I just believe God meant what he said and said what he meant. And you notice how the church has died out. Take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Think about that. The Bible, the spiritual word, is like a sword, and a sword is sharp on both sides. You jab it in a calf. If you want to kill a cow, drive it right there. If you know where his heart is, you go right in and die right there. Or a horse. Or a hog. You know, they get them hogs and they jab that in there and then whack his throat and he bleeds. You know, but that's what you call a sword. And that's what Jesus said. He gave me you a sword. That when the enemy come like a flood, God jabs him right in the mouth. God drops him right in his chest. And he stops that devil before he stops you. He cuts that devil off of you. I said he drives that sword right into the devil's eyeball. He drives that devil out of you.
Hallelujah.
The devil leaves your temple. You become a temple of God, not a temple of the devil. You become a house of God. You become the sword of the Spirit, cuts you loose from the devil. It sets you free from the powers and rulers and darkness. Praying always with all prayers, supplication of the Spirit, watching therewith with all perseverance. Supplication for all saints. Think about that. Man, ain't Paul, man, he really made a preacher here. I've heard people preach against Paul. I said, well, you leave him alone. Are you going to have me on your hide? I'll be like a monkey. I'll jump on your back and you can't get me off. You can't whoop a monkey. He'll jump on, he'll jump on your back and you can't get him off. Glory. You know, I was a seventh son of the other six. And they was more scared of me than they were my brothers. I said, don't mess that little old guy. Said, he'll jump on you like a hen on a June bug. He'll jump on you like a hen on a June bug. Anybody ever heard that one? Like a hen on a June bug. Hallelujah. Glory. And that's what we got to do. We got to jump on the devil like a hen on a June bug. A hen see a June bug, he'll get him. Of course, you city people don't know nothing, but thank God I was raised in country. You know what I'm talking about. Y'all better get out of country and learn a little bit. All you city slickers. Well, these city folks, they don't even know which is which. But I'll hush on that one. I want you back. For me, Paul said, for me that utterance may be given to me, that I might open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery. You know, it touches me. If you pray for me, pray for me, and I've been out here longer than any evangelist in history. Pray that no matter what happens, that I'll stay what I've been with. And there's nothing in my heart could faze me. I'd rather lift my eyes and go into heaven. I'd like to be at home when that happened. They had to ship me home on a box. I'm going to stand. This word has opened doors in country that other people got killed for. For less truth. For I'm an ambassador. I like that. Now, let me read it again. To make known the mystery of the gospel, Paul is saying there in 19. The good news, the secret. To speak the secrets. You know, we miss out. So much is in this word that church folks, especially modern church, never get to the real meat. That can give you something to stand. Amen. That when the enemy comes in like a blood, like a flood, that the gospel, the word of God, the Bible said, that you've been taught from a child, the Bible said. Bible said you've been taught from a child. What? The Holy Scriptures. But see, that ain't happening. That was happening in my day and maybe your day. I don't know how old you are, but I'm 39 holding. And I'm right there beside of Moses, and he started out. Hallelujah. Glory. And he was twice that age and a little more. And God told me, as I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. The day I had my birthday, and I was old as him when he started. He said, as I was fasting, he said, as I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. And he'll be with you. As he was with Peter, you know, they put him in jail, but they praised God in jail. Amen. I said, they praised God, and they didn't get the mully grubbed. They shouted in jail. They praised God in jail. They didn't get the mully grubbed and said, oh, I'm sorry. I won't do that no more. But they said, you let me out, and I'm going right back out there, praise God, and start preaching Jesus. That's what we need. I'm getting right back out on the highways. I'm getting right back out there, and I'm going to get that old cross up, and I'm going to put Jesus on it. I'm going to say, this is Jesus of Nazareth, and if you don't come through him, you're going to hell. If you don't have his blood to cleanse you, you're going to hell. I said, if you don't come out of the world, you're going to hell. If you don't lay aside every sin and every weight that hinders you, you're going to hell. Wake yourself up. Sanctify yourself by the word of God. Bible said we are sanctified by the word of God. That means set aside. The reason some of us ain't sanctified, we ain't been sanctified by the Bible. Let's make known the gospel for which I'm an ambassador in bonds, chains, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to. I appreciate I'm not in chains. The whole world has opened up to us. That you also may know my affairs and how I do. Can't pronounce that word. Beloved brother, and be faithful. Ministers in the Lord shall make known to you all things. God wants us to be not just preachers, but men of God with armor on. Whom I have sent to you for the same purpose, that you may know my affairs, that he might comfort your hearts. Peace be to the brethren. Love with faith from God the Father, the Lord Jesus. Grace be with them that love our Lord Jesus Christ sincerely. Amen. Paul, you know, you may not know this. Paul is writing these final messages before they put him in prison, and he hollers, "Guard, I'm ready." It just says, they put him in there and they was waiting, trying to make up their mind. He said, "I'm ready for the chop block. I'm ready for the scaffold. I'm ready to offer myself now. I persecuted the church, and it's owed to me. I'm just paying for my sins. I'm ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand." Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I just love Paul's teachings. Thank God, it's been such a blessing. Glory. God wants me and you to be heirs and joint heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's come around the altar and have a good prayer together for the evening service and get the sick in here. What's today?
Sunday.
Really the first day of the week, huh? They say Sunday's a bad name. Really? In history was. They had first day, second day, third day, fourth day, sixth day, and this was supposed to be the Sabbath.
That's right.
You know, in the Bible. This supposed to be the last day, supposed to be yesterday. And then we started all over first day of the week, which would be today. Come on, let's come around the altar and have a prayer and get some sick in here. If you know people, and if you know people,